Good evening, Mr. Bond fans. Recently I uploaded the next in my in-depth James Bond movie review series, and it was of course focused on License to Kill. First of all, I just want to say a huge thank you to everyone who watched that video, commented on it, liked it, shared it around and everything. It means an awful lot. It's honestly one of the videos that I'm most proud of on this channel, actually, particularly in that in-depth movie review series, which I do consider the kind of bread and butter videos, if you will. So just thank you for the positive feedback. It's been really well appreciated. Thank you so much. And this video is kind of in response to some of the messages and comments I received about that video, because in that video I showed a very short clip of what was the original License to Kill review video on this channel from, like, God, 2009, 2010, something like that.
Just psyching myself up for this one. Okay, welcome back to another edition of My Weekly One. This week we're going to be looking at what is quite possibly my most loathed James Bond adventure, License to Kill. Okay, go!
So I had a few messages saying, like, oh, could you please upload the original one of that? Could you share it around? It might be interesting to see how your opinions have changed over the years, because as I say in that main video, it's I used to really not like License to Kill very much, and now I consider it one of my favourite Bond films, funnily enough. Just briefly, for those of you who might be slightly newer to the channel, there was an original run of Bond movie review videos on this channel. They're all about 15 minutes worth each. It was called My Weekly Bond, and each week would, like, upload a new one. I recently did a video similar to this for the very first review, the Dr. No one. So that was like an anniversary special video upload, so check that out if you haven't already for an example of what this is gonna be. Because I never would just re-upload those old videos again. I would have to sort of give some context, commentary even, which is what this is. And the main reason why I'm doing it is because I feel like, for me as well, it's kind of interesting to go back and see an old video of myself talking about this film and maybe looking at how my opinions have changed over the years. Like I say, I took a little snippet from this video for my main recent License to Kill review. I didn't watch the video in its entirety because, quite frankly, the cringe factor is just too much. So here, you're gonna experience the cringe with me, folks. So we're gonna watch it through and yeah, maybe just talk a little bit a few points about how my opinion has changed over the years and the heinous things I probably said in my youth about this film that I now love an awful lot. So here we go, folks. We're gonna travel back in time 12 years now to the original review that appeared on this channel of License to Kill. Let's go.
Sorry, just psyching myself up for this one. Okay, welcome back to another edition of My Weekly One. This week we're going to be looking at what is quite possibly my most loathed James Bond adventure. License to Kill. Okay, go!
Started off on a positive note.
So after the gun barrel sequence, we cut to Bond in a car with his friend Sharky, played by Frank McRae, and Felix Leiter, played here by David Penison from Live and Let Die.
David Penison's back? But what happened to the guy from The Living Dead? Oh no, actually, I'm not going to complain. Continue.
The trio are off to Leiter's wedding, until the DEA pops up and tell Felix that some drug lord named Franz Sanchez is nearby and they're going to catch him, so Felix decides to go along too.
We've got the green light!
Let's go!
Hey, Felix! Felix! Haven't you forgotten something?
Oh!
What do you mean, oh? Did Felix really just forget he was on his way to get married?
Sorry, Sharky.
Hey, Blackie! Hey, you guys, you can't do this to me! What will I tell you?
Just tell her the truth, Sharky, that her fiancé is postponing their wedding so he can go and catch some Colombian drug lord. I think that's a perfectly reasonable excuse.
Bond follows, and it's here we're introduced to our main villain, Franz Sanchez, played by Robert Darby, who we see here beating his cheating girlfriend, Loopy, played by Talisa Soto, telling us immediately that this is going to be a much more harsh and brutal Bond film than what we've become accustomed to over the years. Bond, Felix, and the DEA arrive at Sanchez's location and charge in to capture him.
Stay here, James!
I'm gonna comment on that slow motion shot now, aren't I? Yep.
Sorry, hang on a minute. Why was that shot in slow motion? Why?
This shot has always really fascinated me because it's just so out of place. There's really no reason for it to be in slow motion. Anyway, Felix and Bond capture Sanchez in mid-flight, then parachute down so Felix can get married. Well, that was a lovely ending to the film. Next week, we'll be looking into another favourite film of mine. Golden... Oh, sorry. Yeah, I forgot that was just the pre-credit sequence.
Just pausing it there for a sec to say that when it comes to making the newer video reviews on this channel, I never go back and rewatch these, sort of mine for, old jokes or anything like that. I know that I'm going to be making some jokes related to a framed picture of Sharky coming up, because that stuck in my mind, but some of these I don't even remember myself. And also, please bear in mind that on YouTube at this time there was a limit of like 15 minutes for an upload. You couldn't upload a video that was longer than 15 minutes, so I'm definitely skipping over an awful lot in this video, and it's kind of fascinating just to be like, no, wait a minute! Why haven't you mentioned that and stuff? But anyway, I just wanted to interject with that.
There's still another 2 hours of this film left. We then see a lot of fun and frolics at Leiter's wedding, which include the Leiters giving Bond a special, Leiter as a gift. Reed setup. Meanwhile, Sanchez bribes some DEA or CIA... Actually, you know what? It doesn't matter. Sanchez bribes someone into helping him escape, which he does. We then cut back to Leiter's, where Bond is just leaving.
Oh, James! I wanted you to have something. You know the tradition? The next one who catches this is the next one who...
No.
Ooh, touchy subject, Della. X-nay on the average, Mary.
As Bond leaves, Sanchez's men break in and kill Della, and Felix has his leg bitten off by a shark. Bond hears the news of Sanchez's escape the next day from this woman.
Your passport, please.
Am I gonna make a joke about the saint here?
What's going on?
Some big drug dealer just escaped.
Wow, now that is an eyebrow raise to challenge that of Roger Moore.
Bond finds Della dead and gets Felix to the hospital before doing some investigating, which leads him to the place where Felix was maimed. Sharky accompanies Bond on his investigation.
Oh, yes, it looks like Sharky's going to be a real integral part of this film. Bond's main male ally. Like Luigi in For Your Eyes Only, Vijay in Octopussy, Tibbet in A View to a Kill, and Saunders in Living Daylights. Oh, I love Sharky. I hope nothing bad happens to him.
Bond bumps into the guy who betrayed Felix, and it looks like Bond's had it when Sharky pops up and saves the day. Bond then pushes the guy into the shark pool with the bribery money he took from Sanchez.
God, what a terrible waste of money.
Oh, Sharky is so damn likable. Oh, but then I really liked Vijay and Tibbet and Saunders. Not so much Luigi. I really can't go getting too attached to this one.
Luigi has really never had that much love on this channel, that's for sure. Oh, here we go. I see, I remember this. I don't remember much about making these videos, but this I do remember. I don't remember doing that.
Anyway, the next day, Bond is apprehended and taken to this house to meet with this mysterious fellow who is surrounded by cats.
Oh my god, a man with cats! Blofeld! Who is it this time? Is it Donald Pleasance? Is it Telly Savalas? Is it Charles Gray?
Just a jump to the left.
Now that's a recurring theme on this channel. This clip.
No, enough of that. God, I love the time warp.
No, it's just M. What an anti-climax that was. Anyway, Bond gets a telling off and his license to kill is revoked due to him going AWOL. Bond, being Timothy Dalton's Bond, gets really pissed off and runs away while being shot at.
Too many people around? That's a bit harsh, isn't it, Em? Yeah, no matter that you'd be shooting the best secret agent you've ever had, a man who has saved the world time and time again, the best 00 agent you are ever going to have. Oh, but no, there are too many people around. Fuck's sake, Em.
Oh!
So Bond, now a rogue agent, boards a ship run by Milton Crest, one of Sanchez's top men, to do some more investigating. He runs into Sanchez's girlfriend here. Then, disaster strikes.
Work, Carr. Thanks, Mr. Crest. Guess what? His name was Sharky.
No, not Sharky. Not Sharky.
Oh, dear. This is what I mean when I say talk about cringe people.
He was so brave.
Oh, really went for this. Really went for
you
this.
You bastard! You bastard!
So, for the most part, throughout this video, I've been kind of sat here like, you know what, this isn't as cringy an experience as I thought it might be, but we just got there, folks. Okay, hopefully it won't get any more embarrassing than that.
Compliments of Sharky.
Take that, you heartless bastard!
Nope, it continued.
I'm not sure I'll ever quite get over this. Anyway, Bond escapes the $5 million in cash and heads back to Felix's house to check his records, where he finds details of an arranged meeting with an ex-CIA agent, Pam Bouvier, played by Carrie Lowell. Bond goes to meet her when Sanchez's men pop up and we have a fight scene in a bar from which Pam and Bond escape and join forces. Oh, I forgot to mention, one of Sanchez's henchmen in this film is played by a very young Benicio del Toro. Anyway, Bond and Pam head to a fictional Latin American country where Bond manages to worm his way into Sanchez's employ as an assassin, as Sanchez doesn't know who Bond is. Bond and Pam then head back to their hotel suite where Q pops up, on leave from MI6.
Really, like, blasting through the story here. I'm just having flashbacks to YouTube's, like, being so strict on the length of videos, and yeah, I can't believe that I'm just glossing over so much. So far, not as negative as I thought it was going to be either. We'll see if we get there.
And they're helping Bond purely out of the goodness of his heart. God, I love Q. He's not a dick. A dick, like M. Anyway, Q supplies Bond with some fancy sniper and he heads off to take out Sanchez.
Watch the birdie, you bastard.
What the fuck? Ninjas? What? Who?
Swore a lot more in those days.
What's going on? Hello? What? Ninjas? Explosion? What's happening here?
Yeah, apparently these ninjas are here on behalf of M to bring Bond back dead or alive. What? Wait a minute, dead or alive? Good God, M, what the hell is wrong with you in this film? Anyway, Sanchez's men eventually pop up.
Glossed over so much story and yet just let these clips run quite liberally, particularly for the time. Certainly wouldn't be doing that these days.
Sorry, Ninja Woman. I don't know who you are. Why have you just suddenly taken over the film? Ah, oh, thank you. It's about time we got some order back into this film.
I think I do the Monty Python thing again, don't I?
Oh my God, what the fuck is that?
It's me.
So yeah, Sanchez takes Bond in, not realising who he is. It's here that Bond spends some time turning Sanchez against the people working for him, leading to Sanchez killing Milton Crest in a particularly gory fashion.
Am I going to be showing all of this as well? Yeah, I'm totally surprised that I would be showing just these clips in almost their entirety when I had to quickly summarize so much plot, and, you know, taking up valuable comment time with all of these clips, I tell ya.
Series.
The next day, Sanchez takes Bond to his base, which is disguised as some kind of faith meditation retreat place. It's here that Bond uncovers Sanchez's dastardly plan. Not that any of this really matters, because Bond was always setting out to apprehend Sanchez for killing Felix anyway, but yeah, Sanchez's plan is just a drug smuggling thing, really. Yawn. Anyway, Bond is recognised as
negativity's coming
being,
through.
Well, Bond by Benicio del Toro and is apprehended, but not before setting a fire off in the laboratory which causes the whole place to go up. Sanchez beggars off, leaving Del Toro to kill Bond with some shredding thing when Pam pops up and kills Del Toro, saving Bond. We then get a big tanker chase, which is actually really cool in a lot of places and probably the main highlight of the film for me.
Probably.
Of course, despite all the explosions and stuff, it all comes down to a one-on-one between Bond and Sanchez.
Completely.
But as we all well know, Bond's a lucky bastard, and he sets a gasoline-covered Sanchez on fire with his lighter from Felix and Della. Read payoff.
Again, just kind of letting the clip play.
I'll be up to see you next week. We'll do some fishing.
Good. I'll be out by then. M called.
He tried to reach you. I think he may have a job for you.
Okay. Felix is looking rather cheerful there. Has anyone actually told him that his wife is dead?
So yeah, the film ends with Bond having a choice between Loopy and Pam. He picks Pam, naturally, probably because no man could possibly put up with the wooden blandness that is Loopy, and instead pimps her out to the son of Kerim Bay, as Bond and Pam get off together in the pool.
Okay, that was a real, drive-by. Good lord. Okay. I'm sat here thinking, like, all right, like 11, 12 minutes into this thing, and it's kind of like, oh, it's not that negative at all, really. And then just like, bam. Wow, okay. Oh, sorry, Lupe.
Why don't you wait until you're asked?
So why don't you ask me?
Ah, yes, I remember not reacting well to the winking fish as well.
Oh my god, what the fuck were they thinking? Oof, the filmmaker's gone mental at that point. Jesus fucking Christ! How could you possibly end the film on that? Jesus fucking Christ, what the shit?
Okay. Yeah, yeah. This is strong. Strong language in these days.
Okay, so the negatives. I don't like how Dalton plays Bond in this. Talisa Soto's Loopy is so wooden you could probably make paper out of it. Despite Robert Darby putting in a solid performance, I have little interest in Sanchez as the main villain. I think the whole revenge plot thing looks good on paper, but in practice is pretty weak, as is the whole drug smuggling thing, which just comes across as being really bland. For the most part, I don't care for any of the action sequences, save the tanker chase at the end. I think they went way, 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 way too far with making M a total dick in this film. Caroline Bliss's Moneypenny continues to be shite, and fucking ninjas, what the hell? However, amazingly, this is probably the first time I've watched this film and actually kind of enjoyed it. The film has quite a few positives, which I really like. I think Cary Lowell as Pam Bouvier is the most interesting Bond girl since Octopussy. Desmond Llewellyn gets a lot more screen time, which is of course wonderful. David Henderson continues to be the best Felix Leiter to this point. Benicio Del Toro makes her a really interesting henchman who really doesn't get enough screen time, and I really, really love the Michael Kamen score. So yeah, who'd have thought I'd not hate License to Kill at all this time round? Like I say, I rather enjoyed it. I think maybe I've learned to appreciate it more on a different level, or maybe the Daniel Craig films have gotten me more used to this kind of harder-edged Bond film. On that note, though, this film really does feel like it's trying its hardest to be tough and brutal, and it just doesn't work for me. It feels a bit too forced and not at all natural. All the extra violence and swearing just feels kind of out of place in a Bond film. But anyway, yeah, I really, really enjoy License to Kill. You know what? I'd take it over Thunderball any day.
So do you know what that means? License to Kill is no longer my least favourite Bond film. I'm not even drunk.
So yeah, I bet you can't believe it, can you? I bet you're absolutely gobsmacked.
I am.
I bet your jaw has dropped to the floor. Of course, that isn't to say that License to Kill is one of my favourite Bond films. On the contrary, I'd still rank it quite low. But still, it's a step forward, I think. But anyway, yes, next time we shall be looking at what is quite possibly my favourite film of the series, GoldenEye.
Hmm. Okay. Well, that was a lot very quickly at the end there. I'm really surprised with how positively I ended that, all things considered, kind of like talking about enjoying the film. Wow, no, I don't remember it that way at all. I did kind of remember a bit of negativity at the end, and I'm most surprised there about commenting on not really liking Dalton very much, because now I consider Dalton's performance in the film to be one of its greatest assets. So I guess my journey towards full-on kind of considering License to Kill something of a favourite did start as early as then, which I'm kind of surprised at, I'm not gonna lie. It wasn't exactly a glowing review by any stretch of the imagination, but I think, yeah, I definitely focused on some of the more positives in it than I remembered. And you know what, I didn't cringe as much as I expected to all the way through that. I hope that you, after watching that, you can kind of understand why I'm not that keen to have these videos without some kind of commentary on this channel. I suppose if there's any kind of conversation that I would like to come out of making this video, it's to kind of ask other people, which Bond films in the series have you changed your opinion on the most over time? Because coming away from that, it wasn't quite as stark a difference to my opinion today as I thought it would be, but certainly the fact that I commented like not liking Dalton's performance, and now I think it's not only his best performance as Bond, I think it's one of the best Bond actor performances in the entire series, and just having that opinion change over, what, 11, 12, 13 years is kind of, yeah, fascinating. So please do let me know your thoughts in the comments section below. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Let me know if you want to see any more of these on this channel, these kind of retrospective re-uploads of this old content. I definitely don't want to make too much of a habit out of it, but if there is a consensus on any one that, you know, people really want to see, maybe we'll get to it someday. And with all that being said, and until next time, Bond fans, so long for now.
We have Mr. Bleeker.